Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. First of all, let's thank to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is giving us some mercies and blessings so that we can still alive and long. And secondly, may salat and salam always be given to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam who has guided us from the darkness to the lightness, from jahiliyah era to Islamiyah era. My name is Abdul Rashid Asmil Mua and I'm from Benegret. And today I want to tell you about the most dangerous sin in Islam, namely shirk. So let's start into it. Shirk is a term in Islam that refers to the biggest sin and the most serious problem in Islam, namely associating associating with something or someone to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Islam rules, belief in the ones of Allah is the basic principle of faith, so that shirk is very contrary of the knowledge of Tauhid. Shirk, our devotion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to false God, this can be like worshipping idols, or worshipping images, or worshipping statue, seeking the intercession of a saint, or imparting different attributes to other beings. Allah says in Al-Quran, so it means surely Allah will forgive the sin of shirk, and He will forgive other sin other than shirk from whom He wills. Quran Surah An-Nisa, verse 48. In Islam knowledge, and there are many types of shirk, but there are only two main types of shirk. The first is shirk akbar, or great shirk. This type of shirk is the most dangerous shirk in Islam, namely associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with other gods or object as object to worship. This could be like worshipping idols, or worshipping images or statue, or ascribing something or someone to divine power. And the second is shirk asghar, or minor shirk. This type of shirk is an act or belief that is more subtle than shirk akbar, or major shirk, but still a major sin. This would be like riya. Riya is when you doing something good, like worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, helping people, or giving people some food, or anything else, but because just to show off, not for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's really include shirk deeds. And the second is sum'ah. Sum'ah is when you're doing something good, like worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or helping people and the others, but because following the others, not because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's same like shirk deeds. And so on. And that's the two main types of shirk in Islam knowledge. And there's other type of shirk, like shirk kafi, or hidden shirk. This type of shirk is a hidden form of shirk, in which a person thinks or acts that if he is the master of absolute master of his life, without seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help and mercy. And next is shirk rubiyah. The shirk occurs when someone thinks that there's a ruler or creator other than Allah in terms of creator, governance, and dominion over the universe. Next is shirk uluhiyah. This shirk occurs when someone thinks that there is a object to worship or worship beside Allah. This could be like worshiping idols, worshiping image or worshiping statue, believing in the dead as intercessor with God, or worshiping supernatural beings. And the last is shirk asma wa sifat. This shirk occurs when someone equates the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or doubt the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that have been explained in Al-Quran and Hadith. So that's the other type of shirk, other than the two main types, that is shirk akbar and shirk Asgard. So maybe you will ask, is there a story that include the shirik in the story? Yeah, there is. So I will tell you one story that include the shirik uluhiyah. Shirik is about Prophet Ibrahim alaihissalam. At the time of Prophet Ibrahim alaihissalam, people worship idols as God that made by his father, namely Azar. Ibrahim grew up as his idol making. Worshippers believe he secretly broke the idol, except the largest one, to challenge their power. When his father discovered the broken idols, Ibrahim asked how they could be God if they couldn't even protect themselves. He started preaching the monotheism and teaching them that there is one unseen God. Ibrahim message conflict with society in North, and he devised a plan to expose the idol's powerlessness. He present the broken idol and passing blame on the largest one. This prompt people to question their belief. So in this story, Prophet Ibrahim alaihissalam want to challenge the belief of society in North, which broke the idols. All the idols except the largest one. And then when the society in North discovered the broken idols, he will ask how they could be God even protect themselves.
Saya kenalin dengan developer saya. Apa? Manager saya.
Themselves. And then he will ask the society in North to ask the largest idol, who broke the small idol, but the largest idol cannot talk and cannot move, so it will be confused and question the belief of society norms. And then there's a story again that I will tell you that in this story, including Shirik Rububiyah. So in the bustling market town, there lived a jeweler named Amir. Celebrated for his masterful craftsmanship, yet Amir held a hidden belief. He thought a clay idol he made granted him his skills. One day, a wise traveler admired Amir's work and inquired about his secret. Amir revealed his practice of lighting a candle before the idol, offering fruits and seeking blessing. The traveler's eye crinkled with understanding, and he was gently explained that Allah SWT is the true source of Amir's talent. Amir realized that he was guilty of shirik rubbiyah, ascribing divine power to the idol. Moved by the traveler's word, Amir aborted the idol, turned to Allah and thanked him for his abilities. Free from his misconception, Amir's craftsmanship flourished even more, becoming a testament to his faith of ultimate soul worship. So, in this story, there's a person for craftsmanship named Amir, but and then he believed that the talent is given by the idols, not from Allah SWT. And one day there's a traveler that Ahmad understood and know about his secret. So he gently explained to the Amir that Allah SWT was the true source of Amir's talent. So Amir realized that he's guilty of shirik rububiyah. And after that, the Amir's work is more successful than before. And then how to avoid the state of shirik. So there's a few ways that I will tell you to you all. The first is understand and strengthen the belief in Tauhid, once of Allah SWT. And the second is increase your taqwa by staying away from Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala prohibition and carrying out His commands. And the third is pray and ask Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala for help to avoid shirik. And the fourth is staying away from shirik practice such as worshiping idols. And the fifth is study Islamic knowledge in depth and follow the teachings of competent scholar. And the sixth is monitor your intention and goals to ensure to seek the pleasures of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala in every day. And the seventh is always remember Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala and self awareness in every activity. And the eighth is take refuge from shaitan temptation by reading a protective verse. And the last is repent if you ever fall into shirik and commit not to repeat it. By doing this step, you can stay away from shirik and draw closer to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala with purity of heart and mind. So the conclusion is we should never try to separate Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, because Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will not forgive our sin. And so let us always be careful and monitor our activity so we're not fall into the shirik. Okay, that's all from my speech. If there are some mistakes, please forgive me. I hope this speech can be good for us until we die. And thank you for your attention. And last I say, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.